Anybody can say I'm born again, anybody can say I'm converted, anybody can say I'm a child of God. Show us the evidence. We don't know your thoughts, we don't know your experience. Nobody knows what change has taken place in your heart. It is your action. Your action now, if they are different from what it was, then we say there's a change in this man. If your language is different today from what it was, we say there's a transformation in this woman. If your attitude, your disposition, the places you used to go, if you're not going there anymore, the clothes you used to wear, you're not wearing them anymore. The things you used to drink, you're not drinking that anymore. The things you used to eat, you're not eating them anymore. And the group, the gang, the evil company you are keeping before, you're not keeping that anymore, then we can see that change. Whatever has happened inside you, that's your personal experience, but it is the outworking of that experience we can see. Then we'll say that this man is converted, this man is transformed, this man is changed, or this woman is converted and transformed and changed. Look at this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I'm asking you the question, can we see the change in your life? Can we see the change in your language? Can we see the change in your dressing? Can we see the change in the company you keep? Can we see the change in the way you spend your time, the way you spend your money, the way you spend your life? Can we see any change at all? In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, therefore if any man be in Christ, you know, there are people that say, well, I'm not claiming to be righteous because I'm not in deeper life. It's not a matter of being in deeper life. If any man be in Christ, if you are truly converted, you are truly born again anywhere. You know, Saul was not converted in a synagogue, in a temple, in deeper life assembly, in a denomination. It was on the road. He met the Lord. And when he met the Lord on the road, that change was there. Anywhere you meet the Lord, in a house, in a fellowship, in an assembly, in a church building, in a crusade, in a retreat, anywhere, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. And it says, old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. All things are God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Immediately we ourselves are reconciled unto God, and we have now the ministry of reconciliation. You will not just say, I'm born again, and then you are not leading other people to be born again. Look at verse 19. It says, to win, that is to save, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. He's giving us a ministry like he gave Saul of Tarsus. And then he said, I did not confer with flesh and blood. I did not ask permission for my friends and my neighbors and my relatives and my family, whether I'm to preach the gospel or not. He said, that's what God has told me to do, and it must be done. I pray that that independent attitude, that freedom, that liberty, liberation, that deliverance, that you know that this is the will of God, and you will not need the permission of anybody to do the will of God. Are they greater than God? Are they competing with God? Are they competing with Christ in your life? Christ has said, this is the way. Walk ye therein. The grace to do that, what you have in Jesus' name. And then other people will follow you. They'll see your good example. They'll see that Jesus truly is your Savior and Jesus truly is your Lord. Then it says in verse 20, now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled unto God. It happened to him. It happened to the Corinthians. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. This is a general thing. If you are really born again, you will see the difference. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Here is Paul the apostle now in later years. Already he has gone through the same process: conviction, conversion, consecration. And now he's telling the other people to don't just come to church, Don't just say I'm part of the Corinthian church. Let's say the conviction, let's say the conversion, let's say the consecration. It says, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't you know that? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor the effeminate, nor the abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. You see that? It says that none of these people, if they continue that way until they die, if they continue that way and they don't have a Damascus Road experience, if they continue that way and there's no conviction, if they continue that way, I go to church, I feel all right, I go to church, I feel okay, I go to church and I'm doing all this and I don't feel, my conscience does not condemn me, because you have not been convicted. That's why your conscience has not condemned you. But your pastoral conviction, this is bad, this is terrible, this leads to hellfire, this is against the way of the Lord. And then you say, who can save me from this body of death? And then you go to the Lord in prayer, Lord, I must be saved, I must be changed, I must be transformed, I must have my own Damascus Road experience. Then it says in verse 11, and such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but she are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. I pray the Lord will affirm that in every soul in Jesus' name. In 1 Peter chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 18. 1 Peter chapter 1, and I'm reading here from verse 18. It tells us the means by which this is done. It tells us it's not our own self-righteousness, it's not our own trial, it's not our own struggle. I'm doing my best, I'm turning over a new leaf. That will not make it, that will not cut it. It is the blood of Jesus that washes and cleanses us, makes us whiter than snow. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 18, for as much as you know that she was not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, from your vain conversation. Silver and gold, I contribute money in the church, that's great, that's great, but that doesn't bring conversion, that doesn't lead to heaven. Get born again first. It says, from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the blood, with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. It happened to him, it will happen to us. We come to point number two now. As we come to point number two, we're looking at the Supreme Commission of an Unconquerable Ambassador. The Supreme Commission of an Unconquerable Ambassador. I want you to come back to Acts of the Apostles chapter 9. Acts of the Apostles chapter 9. I'm reading now from verse 6. Again, from verse 6 it says, and he trembling and astonished said, Lord. Now he called him Lord. He accepted him as Lord. He received him as Lord. He submitted to him as Lord. There are some people, they say, well, Jesus is my Savior, but I'm still struggling with making him Lord. Think about that. Are you the one to make him Lord? He is Lord already. The Father has made him Lord and given him a name above every name, that at the mention of the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. He is Lord. He told his disciples, you call me Master and Lord. You say, well, for so I am. He's already Lord. It's for you now to submit, to surrender, to consecrate, to yield unreservedly unto him, that you recognize he is Savior, you recognize he is Lord, and there's no part of your life that is being lived outside his control, outside his sovereignty, outside his authority. You accept him, you know him, you submit to him as Lord. In verse 6, he said, Lord, what will you have me to do? When you look at that verse, Lord, have me. Lord, have me to do. Lord, what do you want me? What would you have me to do? Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do, not what thou may do. All your own agenda, push it to the side. If you're really born again, all your past aspirations, ambition. This is what I would like to be. I like to be popular. I like to be a politician that will arrest all these people and bring them back to Jerusalem. Leave all that alone. Now, what will you have me to do? Arise and go to Damascus to show what you must do. In verse 7, and the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth. And when his eyes were opened, he saw no man. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither did he eat nor drink. What's that? Not eating, not drinking. I said, what's that? Fasting. He fasted because he said, I want, already now he lost his sight. He couldn't see anymore because of that light that came from heaven. But he didn't say, if this new way, if it's good, why have I lost my sight? If this new direction I'm to go is good, why this and why that? Already he said, it's my Lord. Let him do with me as it pleases him. And now he gave himself to prayer. All the people that traveled with him from Jerusalem to Damascus, they only led him there. We're not told they joined him. We're not told they agreed with him. We're not told they were also born again. We're not told they were converted as well. Other people are looking for, who is joining me? Who is supporting me? Who is helping me? Who is encouraging me so that I can be in this Christian life? Who is following up on me? When you are born again, you'll be the one seeking the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. When you're truly born again, it's not that somebody is running after you. Will you come to church? And no, I have my own church, your own church, your own religion of the past. That's, you know, Saul had his own church, he had his own assembly, he had his own religion, he had his own teacher, Gamaliel, but now he said, I forsook everything. And the Lord announced to him, let me read to you now from verse 10. It says, and there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias, and he said, behold, I am here, Lord. I am here, Lord. You see, all those Christians in the early church, they just received the Lord as their Lord. They submitted to the Lord as their Lord. And any time, any day, the Lord called them. There was no question. They obeyed the Lord implicitly. They obeyed the Lord promptly. They obeyed the Lord completely. They obeyed the Lord wholeheartedly without any question. Immediately God called Ananias and said, Ananias, here am I, Lord. He called him Lord. And then he said, behold, I'm here, Lord. In verse 11, and the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the street which is called Straight. This is what we call the word of knowledge. He was not an apostle, but just a disciple in Damascus. And the Lord revealed to him the name of Saul and the experience of Saul and the place where Saul was. He knew that. That's word of knowledge. And that's what we say today. If you are born again, praise the Lord. If you are sanctified, praise the Lord. If you are filled and baptized in the Holy Ghost, praise the Lord. The Lord will reveal himself to you more and more. Definite knowledge coming from the Lord to tell you this is the way to go. This is who to contact. And then we're told it's in the street called Straight. Inquire. And in the house of Judas, for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayed. The Lord even to announce what the man was doing. He was praying. You see, he was converted. Why was he still praying? Born again already. Why was he still praying? This shows you now that before Ananias got there, this man was praying for deeper experiences in the Lord. He said, Lord, all this is new. I've submitted myself to you now. What will you have me to do? I don't know how great that assignment will be, how broad, extensive that assignment will be. But here I surrender everything. I surrender everything. I give up everything. Whatever it is you want in my life. One by one, he was laying everything down on the altar. That's what we call consecration. All those 3 days of not eating and not drinking and fasting and waiting before the Lord. He wasn't even praying for his eyes. He wasn't praying for material things. Oh Lord, I commit myself. I surrender myself, Lord, do something in me. He had read the Old Testament through and through before this time. He knew about sanctification. He knew about pure heart and clean hands. And he said, Lord, clean up my hand. Clean up my heart and cleanse everything. Sanctify me. That's what he was praying for at that time for all those 3 days. And when you are truly born again, there'll be a thirst. There'll be a hunger in you. You want to know more of God. You want to go deeper in the Lord. You want to lay everything on the altar. You want the fire of the Holy Ghost to come and purify and sanctify your heart completely. You want to stretch yourself before and say, Lord, if there is any iota of self still remaining, take everything away. For all those 3 days, he will not talk to any man, any woman. He was praying unto the Lord. And then we're told, and he has seen, look at verse 12, and he has seen in a vision, that is even Saul now, he has begun to see visions. I've seen a vision, a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Ananias answered, Lord, I've heard by many of this man how many evil he has done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel. You see that? The Lord was saying, Ananias, that this man is converted already. He's now not just an ordinary follower. He is a vessel. Not only that, he is a chosen vessel. Who is a chosen vessel? Somebody who is converted. Who is a chosen vessel? Somebody whose vessel is cleansed. Cleansed. Inwardly cleansed. Inwardly purified. Inwardly sanctified. I read it to you in the Bible just now. That when we talk of a vessel unto honor that is going to be used of the Lord, it's not only that you are saved, you are also sanctified and purified. And that is what he had been praying for. Now we are told that the Lord said that he just go your way. He is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and the kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Ananias went his way and entered into the house and putting his hands on him said, what did he say? Tell me out loud. Brother Saul, was he born again? Was he saved? Before Ananias got there, was he converted already? Of course, yes. That's why Ananias first of all complained. Said, Lord, this man you are sending me to is not a believer. This man you are sending me to is an injurious person. He's a persecutor. He even has letters of authority in his hand to lay hands on anybody calling upon you. And then the Lord said, he's a chosen vessel. Ananias understood that to mean that the man had been converted. Can the Lord bear testimony concerning you like that? That through and through, your heart, your soul, your mind, your brain, every part of you, within and without, can the Lord bear testimony concerning you that you are a chosen vessel, that you are born again? He knows you through and through. He knows your life. He knows your thoughts. He knows what you are doing. He knows where you are now. He knows your intention, what you are still planning to do. Can the Lord, knowing everything about you, tell another person he is converted, he is consecrated, he is sanctified, a chosen vessel? And so Ananias got there and said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, has sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received his sight forthwith and arose and was baptized. There is healing still today. I said there's healing still